told you that there is a love that makes a way and never holds you back. So won't you break free, won't you break free, get up and dance in his love. Won't you break free, won't you break free, get up and dance in his love. This one and only son, taking a stand upon the cross to show his perfect love. So won't you break free, won't you break free, get up and dance in his love. Won't you break free, won't you break free, get up and dance in his love. The freedom that has come our way, offer our lives to see the glory of your name. So won't you break free, won't you break free, get up and dance in his love. Won't you break free, won't you break free, get up and dance in his love. Love never ending, no escaping the truth, no mistake. Can it's you, God forever will. Get up and dance, get up and dance, praise you. No escape in your life, no mistake in your life. God forever will. Get up and dance, get up and dance, and praise you. And for all our days, we are holding on, holding.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You can be seated. I'm glad y'all are here this morning. This is a big morning for us. It's going to be a lot of fun. We had a big time already at 9:30 this morning. We had a family coming in together and a child baptized at 9:30. And now we are here at 11 o'clock and we have more of our youth being baptized here at the service. So this is a special Sunday. This is a time where within the Methodist Church, all churches work a little bit differently. For us, you can be baptized as an infant in the Methodist Church, and it's a commitment that your parents make and that the church makes together to see you raised in a place where you know you are loved and there's a God who is with you all the time. It's a covenant that a parent makes with a child and the church makes with that family and with that child. So we have some who are coming today and they will be remembering their baptism, even though they probably won't remember it too well. So that's why we are okay with them getting wet again and remembering. We'll have some who are coming in and they will be baptized today. They're coming on what we call a profession of faith, coming and saying, I believe that Jesus Christ is the one who's come to make life possible for me and for all people. To redeem all of creation. And so today, you all get to be the voice of the church around the world as you speak to say, and guess what? As you make this commitment in your life, you're not at it alone. And so it's a special morning. We're really excited about it. So glad that you're here to be a part of the morning. A couple things kind of make sure that you know are going on. We have baptism can be done in three different ways within the church. One is to be completely immersed, and that is what's going on right here. We will have our folks today are going to be immersed. You can also be sprinkled or poured. And some that have been baptized will not be baptized. We have one of our guys today, but will come and kneel here and take ownership of his faith as well. Anybody got any thoughts, any questions before we move into this time together? All right, now parents, you're invited to come up as we call your child's name to come up here with them. And here's how we're going to line up, all right, make sure we got everybody right. Okay, the first person we call comes here, and the second one here. Y'all getting how this is going to work? And the third family right here. Okay, we're going to work our way across. All right, now after, if you're being baptized, when you go underwater, come back out, you'll come on this side, out the other side, and Rebecca will have a towel for you, dry you off, and then you can head on out here and get changed. Parents, you're welcome to go back to your seat. I've heard that sometimes moms have responsibilities here to fix hair again as well, so if you gotta do that, you can come right out here to the bathrooms and get all that done. Make sense for you? All right. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Through confirmation and through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew the covenant declared at our baptism, acknowledge what God is doing, and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church.
Jacob Matthew to be baptized and confirmed. We invite Whitley Marie to remember her baptism and be confirmed. And we invite Jackson Paul to be baptized and confirmed.
So here you go. You see who they are. I'm going to ask y'all to all now turn and look at me. Just so y'all know, everyone out there, you've got a part coming up, so be ready, okay? Today, I'm going to ask all of you who are coming for this time of baptism and confirmation, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, your answer is, I do. Say it with confidence. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, your answer is, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord, in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, your answer is, I do. According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in this world? If so, your answer is, all of you, I will. Will you faithfully participate in the ministries here at Midland with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, your answer is, I will. All right. Now, we're going to join together, all of us, including you all up front and you all out there, professing the Christian faith as contained in the Scriptures of the Old and in the New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in Jesus Christ? And do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Now I ask all of you out there, One of the things that we know about these moments is not them stepping out alone, but it's them stepping into faith with all of us. And so I ask this question for all of you who are here today. Parents, you're welcome to answer as well. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include now these persons before you in your care? Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and you brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water, and after the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. All right, Ansley. You ready? Come on here. All right. There you go. You're good. Watch your step. All right, you're going to sit right there. And you're going to face out towards... All right, now you're going to put your hand right on your nose there. There you go. All right, you ready? Other hand's going to go right here. Ansley, remember your baptism on this day and be thankful. Oh, very well. Now, family, I'm going to invite y'all, if y'all want to come over, put hands on this wet one right here. Ansley, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, bud. I have you kneel right here. Yeah, all right, family, you can put hands on too. Aiden Robert, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, Don. All right, Nikki, you ready, bud? Might want to take those off, too. There you go. There you go, bud. Step on in. All right. You're going to sit right there and face out this way. All right. You can put your hand on your nose right here. There you go. And Dominic Robert, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Family, when we get y'all to come in here, as you're able, put your hands right here with Nikki. Nikki, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, bud, you're going to step right in here. Good job. All right, handling those there. Jacob Matthew, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. There we go. All right, family, I want to invite y'all to come over here. Jacob, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, grab the nose. Let our hands go right here. There you go. Whitley Marie, I baptize, or remember your baptism on this day and be thankful. And family, I would invite y'all to come and join him. Whitley, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, you ready? All right, you grab your nose. Put this other hand right here. Jackson Paul. You get it right? Jackson Paul. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Oh. Family, I'm going to invite you to come. Stay right here. Stay right here. You're good. You're good. Family, come right in here. Jackson, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. It's a great thing that we get to do, and as they go, and now some of them get dried up. As families, remember this moment, maybe have a time to celebrate together later on. Let's take a moment here together as a body of Christ to say a prayer. Let's pray. You are the God of all grace, and you have called us to eternal glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. God, you establish us and you strengthen us by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may live in grace and peace throughout your life and forever. And these are the things that we celebrate on this day, knowing that God, in these moments, as we come with a purpose and as we speak with a purpose, God, as we say words spoken time and time again now for centuries, and as we say them anew today, it reminds us that you are the God who always has been and always will be. You are the God who has been working throughout all of creation. You created and you sustain. That you are the God who's made promises, and you are the God who keeps those promises. And for all those things, this morning we say thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. And invite your feet as we join together in a song this morning. Come and drink. Let's pray. Guys, we come into this place. We come. God, the faithfulness you have displayed in our lives and throughout all time. God, remembering the great things that have come because you are a great God. Remembering the words that Jesus spoke. And yet, God, they are not just words that were spoken, but continue to be true for us today. God, as we remember what has been, we find ourselves in the moment now, holding tight to these promises and living with faith into the future, no matter what comes our way. And God, for all the hope you fill us with, we give you thanks today. And we pray these things in your name. Amen. You may be seated.
How many of you thought that was pretty cool? Nobody? Oh, okay, Bennett thinks it's cool. I'll take that. All right, so we've been learning about someone. He's kind of special. Anyone? Any guesses? Zachary. Well, Peter was definitely in one of our stories. We've been learning a lot about Jesus, though, right? And how many of you know that Jesus is pretty cool, and if you give things to him, he can make it even bigger and better? Because he's got magic. I mean, he might. He's got Jesus magic, which is pretty awesome. And we're going to go read a story about this time where, how many of y'all like to share your lunch? Oh, lots of good sharers around here. How many of you would rather keep your lunch for yourself because the good stuff's in there? You can be honest. Those are my kids. Well, we're going to go read a story about this time where a boy decided to share his lunch with 5,000 people. That's a lot of people, huh? That's a good question. Why did he have so much lunch? Well, what if he didn't have so much lunch and he was just being generous? You know this story? I'm so glad. We're going to go learn a little bit more about this story. Y'all want to say a quick prayer with me? All right. Dear God, thank you for loving me. Help me to be generous and to love others, and share. Amen. All right, friends.
Too much fun. Sometimes it's too much fun, you know. There we go. There we go. A couple things to make sure y'all are aware of. We had a great time on Wednesday this past week, right out here in the yard. The parents and the youth all joining together for some good food, and then a great time playing some volleyball out there. It is confirmed. Parents win. You know, we tried to give as much grace as we could and free points and all kinds of other stuff, you know, but I just want y'all to know, parents won. It was great. Had a lot of fun. It's so, for me, maybe for my role here at the church, but also just as a parent as well, I love the opportunity to get together, sit around the table with other parents and with my kids at the same time, see the fun that we got to have out there, from playing to cheering them on to just having a good time sitting around talking. So all the parents that were out there, thank you so much. All the youth, we love y'all. Y'all are awesome. We have our last big night coming up this Wednesday before summer gets here, and so it's going to be the big old slip and slide that goes down the hill in the back. It's awesome. It's lots of fun. We happen on Wednesday night, 6 o'clock, so you want to make sure you wear something you are comfortable getting wet in, and also make sure it's something that's okay to get wet in, please, all of you youth out there, okay? And any parents who want to come too, we understand it's going to be a lot of fun. If you want to stick around and help chaperone and enjoy, you know, 100-foot of slip and slide, you're welcome to do that as well. So we got that coming up, going on. Also, if you'll take a look when you came in, got a bulletin in your hand, there is a QR code on there. Scan that code, check in with us this morning, let us know you're worshiping with us. If you are a guest with us, we're so glad you're here, especially on a Sunday like this. It's a special Sunday. Fill that information out for us. Anything you're comfortable sharing with us gives us the chance to connect with you and your family as well. We've got our big AmeriKids happening this summer. It's going to be awesome. It's on June 13th to the 17th. This is for all of our kids age 3. Potty trained. Three potty trained. You got to be potty trained if you're 3. All right. If you're not potty trained yet, you're not ready for this. Okay. Because it's going to be too crazy. So if you're not potty trained yet, no, but 3 potty trained up to 12, sign up. So we're going to have a chance to have all the kids up here with Sadie. Some of y'all may know them as like the Helton family, even though she has a different last name now. It's Sadie Brooks back there are putting this on, and we've got some of our folks here at the Choice Church joining up with her and her family to make this possible for the kids. Awesome time of learning some songs and a good production for us to enjoy. And so make sure you're going to get signed up now. If you'd like to volunteer, you can go to the website as well and sign up to be a volunteer for that week as well. We'll have the offering coming along later in the service. The ushers are going to pass the plates. You can drop in. If you like to fill out connection cards by hand, you can see them in the back of chairs there. You can drop those in along with your offering at that time. If you'd like to give online, you can scan the code. You may even try it from the slide if you're really good with your phone, or on the bulletins when you came in, and you can give online this morning. I think that covers most of our announcement stuff. Am I missing anything? No? All right. So here's it. Yes. Man, that's a great announcement. Yes. Thank you. He's the boss of this, too. So it's going to be a great time. In 2 weeks, we are having We Are Midland on Sunday morning. That means there will be one service. We do this on 5th Sundays, and so there will be one service. It's going to be happening in here with breakfast. Now, the way we do breakfast around here is you cook or bring whatever's your favorite thing to eat for breakfast and let all of us try it out. So that's how it works. It's amazing. If you've never done anything like covered dish, you hear it called a lot of times at Midland, you definitely need to come try it out. We eat well around here, and so it'll be in this room. One service, 9:30, getting together for breakfast, and then we'll have worship immediately following. So there'll be tables set up throughout this space. All are invited to come out and to enjoy it. We know it's Memorial Day weekend, so some of you may be out of town, but any of you hanging around and want to have a good time and eat some food, come on up here, bring your favorite breakfast with you, and we're going to enjoy the time around the table, 9:30, worship immediately following in this space. Thank you. Any questions? Y'all got this make sense? Good. Man, okay, I got a statement to get started here today as we begin to wrap up this series looking at this idea of growing up to a childlike faith. And this is what I think is pretty true, but I'm wondering if maybe you've noticed this as well, is that, oh man, that is going to look funky. You got to click the first one, I think, hopefully, maybe. No. If you click the first slide of that file, and it does this, we're going to have fun. Okay, I want you to read between the lines. Act like you're smart people, please. I don't know how it was doing that, but that is funky looking right there. Hey, do it. Jared, yes, there we go. Jared can do it. There's a file. If you right-click on it, you can name that whole file right there a sermon, I think it is, and it'll work better. Anyway, if you can't read it, this is the idea. That technology is enabling us and enabling more and more things to be done for us and enabling us to do more and more things on our own. Have y'all noticed this? That technology is enabling more and more things to be done for us and for us to do more and more things on our own. Now, if you've ever been to Walmart, I know you have to have experienced this at this point, because there's certain times you can go to Walmart and you have no option anymore. You're going to be checking yourself out. You know what I'm talking about? How many of y'all are good at that? How many of y'all have been checking yourself out at Walmart and been going, you know what? I'm not sure why they ever struggled with this when I was trying to check out before. Anybody been there? Yes, absolutely. Go on, confess your sins here, you know, among your, that's right. Been there, man. I go in and I'm looking at it, I'm going, this is so easy. Watch, you scan it and it pops up there and I stick it in the bag. When I get ready to pay, I just hit pay right there and I scan. Look at that, it's amazing. Now, I know good and well, technology has gotten a lot better, and over these years now we're able to, you know, do things that at one point those working behind the register were not able to do. I get that. But man, that is something easy. But what I think it indicates is that we have these things in our world that are moving us to this place of being able to do it by ourselves. You can now go to Walmart and not interact with anybody You can watch if you'd like, and then go out and never say a thing to anyone. It's all by yourself. Now, I'm not sure if y'all have experienced this. I'll tell you the Walmart story to talk about my trip to Gettysburg. When I went to Gettysburg a couple weeks ago. While we were going up there, it's a pretty long drive, and we had to find a place to stop. It was a group of us pastors here from South Georgia riding up in a church bus, which is a lot of fun. Put a bunch of pastors on a church bus, you know, and ride along. And so we had to find a place to eat, and we found that if you go to North Carolina, anybody been to North Carolina recently? Yeah, there's no place to eat after 1:30 in the afternoon or something like that, all right? So it's getting later, and we can't find anywhere to eat until we find the beloved McDonald's. How many of y'all love some McDonald's? Now, here's the truth. I don't eat McDonald's very much because Burger King, right, is the real place to go. But McDonald's was available, and it was open, and you could actually go in and eat at this one. And so we went in, and I encountered, like, this thing that completely baffled me and threw me off. There was nobody standing at a register to take my order. Y'all experienced this yet at McDonald's? You go in there, and they have, like, this big screen, like, taped up to a big old pole in there, and you got to go over there and order your food yourself now. And so I found that when you go over there, you got to push buttons and wake it up and then hope that it's still logged in. And when it finally pops up for you, you order your own meal. But the deal is when you pick what you want, you then have to answer another question. Is that all you want or would you like some more? And then you push another button. Y'all know what I'm talking about yet? And then it's like, would you like to make that a large? You're like, absolutely not. I don't want to make that a large. And so you skip that. And if you're like me, you get to the fries and you're like, absolutely, I'd love a large fry, right? And so you add to that. So here I was ordering my food, looking at, you know, this TV thing and trying to touch the right buttons at the right time and working my way through it, totally confused as to what I'm doing. I finally get my order in. Literally, it was taking me, I think, about 10 minutes from the time I walked into McDonald's to finally get an order in. Y'all been there yet? I get my order in, and let's not even talk about how long it took them to get me an order after I had taken 10 minutes to make the order. Because I'm looking back there, and they all, it's not that they're standing around just like eating fries, like some people like to blame them for, you know. They are running around crazy. I'm like, y'all are as confused as I am right now. You know what I'm saying? When I get done with my order, a number pops up on the screen. I'm like, okay, I must be number such and such. When I pay, another number, a different number, y'all been here, pops up. And I'm like, daggum, which number am I? When my receipt prints out, which I'm going, this will be fine. I got a receipt. I'll go with the number on my receipt. The ink is out of the printer. So now I have nothing. I have a blank piece of paper as my receipt. I'm staring at this thing. I'm listening to them call out numbers out there. I'm going, is it this number or this number? It's 10 minutes. They still hadn't called anything out. So you just walk up and you're like, what's that? That is, I forget what it was. It was some type of hamburger and fries. You know, I was like, I think that's mine, you know? And I just take it and walk back to my seat. I have no idea whose meal I ate that day, but it was not a large fry. You know what I'm talking about? Yes. There's something about us moving in this world to be able to do things alone, to do things by ourselves. But how many of y'all know there's certain things in life you just shouldn't do alone? You know what I'm talking about? This one time, one more story for y'all today, then I'll be done. Okay, one more story. My wife is in charge of the food stuff at our house, which is great. She cooks really well. She makes sure we got the food in place that we need. She does like the Walmart order thing, you know, and make sure we put it in the right spot, all that kind of thing. We came to a place with four kids in our house that we realized one refrigerator, no matter how big that thing is, it's not enough, and we needed another one. And so we're going to take our current refrigerator and move it to another place and get a new refrigerator to put in the kitchen. And she did some great research and actually found one that we could buy locally from someone else for a lot cheaper. In fact, she sent me a message and said, this is like an amazing deal. I'm not sure if this really exists, but do you mind checking it out? It was in Phoenix City, which got us questioning quite a bit, because when you cross the line, you know what I'm talking about. I'm just kidding. So we're going over, and I go over, and I check, and sure enough, like, this is a nice, I mean, really nice refrigerator. It's got ice and water stuff on the front, and I'm looking at it, I'm like, what in the world? Why are y'all selling this for so cheap? It's like, well, you know, we're changing things out. We're moving. We got to get rid of this, and, you know, we just have no use. I'm like, okay, cool. I go home, you know, that night I have a meeting downtown at St. Luke, and so I'm going, this will be good. We're already right there at the border. You know, we can kind of cross on over. I'll get a couple people to help me. What are y'all laughing about? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Your time changes and everything. And so it does. And so I get my dad, which is great, and Will. How many of y'all know Will Manis? He works with our teenagers here. Will was at this with me, and I said, hey, man, could you possibly help me out? Because who knows, good and well, you can't move a refrigerator alone. You know what I'm talking about? And we go over there, and we walk in. I think my dad and Will both looked at me like, you didn't tell us about this. I didn't think about this. It's one of those split-level homes. Y'all ever been to one of those? And when you walk in, you walk into this floor, then you kind of go up a little flight of stairs, and there sits a refrigerator that we're to get out. The great thing about it is the door is not lined up with that staircase at all. And so to get it out the door, why are we selling this for so cheap? Because we can't get it out of here. If you can, we will save you money. We have to pick up this refrigerator and like over the railing, right? And by the way, the owner of the house, I'm going, man, you should really respect your house more than this because we're sliding that junk down your stair rail right now. You know what I'm saying? We are trying to pick it up over the stair rail thing, and over then we had to like get down the stairs going, because you know, down this way, turn around, like downstairs trying to hold it up and get this thing out the door. There's some things in life that are better to do not by yourself. You know what I'm saying? As we were looking at a hot tub this morning, I thought, you know, getting in a hot tub, you know, you can fall asleep in there. It's just better not to do that by yourself. Rock climbing, I feel like it's one of those things in life. It's better just not to do by yourself. That 30-inch pizza, by the way, that if you eat the whole thing, you can have it for free. It's better not to do that yourself. You know what I'm talking about? There's just certain things in life that you shouldn't do alone. And I think that there's some things in life that you can't do alone. And that's what I want to look at this morning. I want to look at those things in life that even though we seem to have in our world a movement towards doing things ourselves, even though we seem to be working to empower ourselves to do things on our own, that there's some things in life that not just you shouldn't, but I'm not really sure you can do alone. And to look at that, I want to take a look at Ephesians chapter 4. Now, if you were here last week, we read this same part, so you're like, I think I know this. Read it with a little bit of a different view this morning. We're going to look at it. Last week was all about how we are called to have a responsibility in this life. Because Paul, and you're going to see it this morning, he says, hey, look, church, you've got a responsibility. Today, we're going to look at it a little bit differently. Because I think the truth is that as we live life, we'll find there's certain things we can't do on our own. One of the things that we know for sure in the church, you can't get baptized on your own. Somebody else has got to be present. And what we like to do is have everybody present to say after you're baptized, hey, we're in this with you. You're not alone. You may have taken ownership of your faith, but that doesn't mean now that you got to do it on your own. We're right here with you throughout your walk. And that's a great thing. And it also, I think, remains true for us as we're trying to grow in our faith. Ephesians chapter 4. Verse 1 gets started like this. This is Paul writing to the church in Ephesus. We know very confidently this letter was written to lots of churches. It's a very general letter addressing life as a follower of Jesus. We love that about this letter. And so this just happens to be, we found the one written with the church of Ephesus filled in at the top of it. And so we call it Ephesians. Here in chapter 4, he gets started by saying this. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Now, I told you this was written to lots of churches. So this wasn't written just to leadership. This wasn't written just to one church who was supposed to step out to lead all the others. This was written to all the folks going to church. Paul says to them, all of y'all are to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. There's a calling in the lives of all of us. Verse 2, be completely humble and gentle and be patient. How many of y'all have got that part down? You've got that. We talked about this last week a little bit. You know, y'all got this down yet? Be completely humble, gentle. And some of you are like, I got that down, but that patient part, Okay, and then when I don't have the patience, I don't remain gentle as long as I should be. You know what I'm talking about? It's a great call for how we're to live life, a little bit of responsibility. But listen to what this next statement is now. Bearing with one another, not alone. How? In love. And that sets us up for today. Living life alongside one another. Living life out of love for the other. Make every effort, he kind of expounds on this, tell you a little bit about what it may look like. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. How? Through the bond of peace. How many of y'all are really good at arguing and you would prefer to argue and win an argument than just to be done and walk away? You don't have to raise your hand if you don't want to, just think it in your head. And start going, I'm so sorry, God, I'm so sorry, right? I'm here, man, let me tell you, there's certain things I'm like, you're just dumb, all right, for even thinking that, and I need to fix you because I love you. You know what I'm saying? Y'all ever been there? We're going to talk about that idea of how we justify what we say by saying, well, I say this out of love. No, you don't, right? You say this because you think you're right, and everybody else needs to be right like you, right? But here's what this call is, to make every effort to do what? To keep the unity How many of y'all are well aware that we are much better at dividing up these days than ever being united? We would rather find how we're different and can't sit in the same room together than how we can be united. Keep the effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through what? Bond of peace. Working towards peace, working towards peace, working towards peace. He goes on, verse 4. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. What's that word? I made it easy for you today. One. One. Unity. One. One. Keeps pushing on that. One Lord. One faith. One baptism. He then moves into this place, what it is for us as people of faith. One God and Father of all, who is over who? All and through who? All and in who? All. That's in the Bible, right? God, the one that joins us together. The one God, who's the Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. God is at work everywhere and in the lives of all people. One of the ways I like to say it is God is working in your life whether you like it or not. And that's pretty amazing. Now, he pushes on with this a little bit, and he calls us now. He has the big but coming in for us of how we're to look at this, because you know what? That doesn't mean we're all the same. Being united does not mean we're all the same. And he says this. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. Hey, we're a little bit different here. This is the fun part. That's why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions, hanging out with us? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. Now, we can break that down. I said it last week. I'll say it again. If you really want to break that down sometime, let's do it when we're not doing a church service for everybody, okay? That'll take us a little time. We can talk through it. But we get a great bottom line to wrap up that point. Once again, what is it about? In order to fill what? Not just the earth, not just these people around here, but I love how Paul writes it, the whole universe, anything we ever find, God in the midst of it. So, Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers. Here comes that idea of those leadership folks in the church. And here's the role of those people in leadership: to equip his people for works of service. Now, this doesn't cover everything. We talked about this last week when we looked at responsibility. All right. This doesn't cover everything that a person in leadership in the church is supposed to do. But this is Paul accenting a part of equipping others to do what? To serve alongside. So that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach, and here's our big thing for the morning, unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of that, the fullness of Christ. A couple things we can learn real quick. Are we there yet? No, we're not. But this is what we're moving towards. This is what we're working towards. This is why we gather together. This is why we sing songs, we pray. This is why when we baptize someone, we don't baptize them by themselves. We baptize them with other people around, because you all today did it, and we do it around the world. We speak on behalf of the followers of Jesus around the world when somebody is baptized and say, we are now going to walk with you through your life. We are making covenant with you as you enter into this covenant with us to be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. He says, now this is the case. Right? That we can reach unity in the faith when this happens, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then, at that point, we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves. You know how we talked about on week two? We talked about the idea of a childlike faith and a childish faith. And there's a difference, is there not? Childlike is a willingness to trust because you know it, you realize you have to trust. Childish is putting on a show and complaining and whining and doing all those things that we tell kids to stop doing, isn't it? And we've met people that have a faith like that. Is it really doing this idea of building us up and bringing us together and uniting us? Can I just say, from what's been going on in the world around us, what's been said in churches and by church leaders that's been so divisive, I think has missed this point completely. That we'd rather divide over things than find a way to be united out of these things. We'd rather find our differences than celebrate the unity found in Jesus Christ. Then, when we get to that point, we're not there yet, it's obvious, we get that, but when we get there, we'll no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people and their deceitful scheming. And nobody wants to go, that's me, do we? Verse 15. Instead of doing that, speaking the truth, how? That's the tough one right there. I mean, it sounds so good. Like, some people are like, finally, the part of this that I love. You know, this is the part where I get to say what needs to be said, Stephen, because you know what? There's some sorry folks out there going, hi, I'm a Christian. I love Jesus. I'm going, no, you don't, right? Because I'm going to speak the truth now. How do you speak the truth? In love. It's very unfortunate in our world today that we do much like I said. It's not a matter of we're speaking the truth in love, but after we've said something we know we shouldn't have said that was more harmful than helpful, what do we say? I just said it because I love you. Who's guilty? Come on. All of us are here. We've said it to our kids. We've said it to our wife. We've said it to the students in our class, right? The kids on our ball team. I just want what's best for you. And if you keep acting like that, you can't have... No, you said it because you were frustrated and you were angry and you're sick and tired of dealing with it. Let's just go and be honest, right? Now, hopefully, some of us are going, no, Stephen, I got it. I can only look at someone and respond out of love. And if you're there, good. You're the one who has matured and you're on the other side that we're all working towards. The rest of us know good and well. We got a lot to work on when it comes to this faith. We got a lot to work on when it comes to this idea of being united in love for one another. Instead, speaking the truth in love, when we do that, then we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ. When we can do that, when we can really be a people speaking the truth in love, then we can be united and we can grow together and mature as the body of Christ, when we can speak the truth in love. For Him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and it builds itself up. What in? There it is again. You want to be united? The best of the best that we can possibly to really mature? You want to be mature? I'm so tired of people calling people out because they're so mature. It's just irritating to me. Well, you know, I've been there before and I just know now. I'm like, just shut your mouth, please. Anybody okay with that? If you start your statement like that, I'm going to tell you to close your mouth. Here's a true story. I had somebody tell me one time, I was working with students, the student ministry. I had received a master's of divinity, which you have to do to become a pastor, you know, kind of thing. And I'd done all that. I was on the same level when it comes to this idea of ordination that he was. And he said to me, well, you know, I used to work with youth too, but now I've moved on to working with adults. And I was like, I just want to punch you right now. You know what I'm saying? And I know we're preachers and we're not supposed to be feeling like that inside. Growing up and maturing. Statements like that may be a sign that we got a lot of growing up to do. Anything that doesn't unite us and pull us together as people of faith. Anything that doesn't build one another up. How in love. In love. And that's the tough part. That's the tough part to check with. From Him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love. And then last week, we ended right there as each part does its work. You got a responsibility. That responsibility may look different for all of us, but one thing that I know we all have in common is working to be united in the faith. As we read through this text this morning, we find pretty true throughout, I think, that Jesus leads and guides, right? Jesus is the one, He's the head, it says, the one that leads and guides the church. And then we have this role, and we hold one another together. We become the ones that stay united to be the body of Christ. You see, the truth is, as we've looked at this morning, you are not and you cannot be in this alone. Your faith, your attempt at it, you're running from it, you're not alone. And you cannot be alone, according to how it's laid out for us here. Some of the things that I've seen, maybe you know something about this, when it comes to our faith, there's certain times that maybe we come to this place where we say, you know what, you just don't get to claim to do it myself. On week two, we talked about how kids say it. Today we talk about how we say it as adults when it comes to our faith. I'll do it myself. No, you won't. We're called to be together in it. Faith is not something we go and do ourselves. Number two, the other side of it, people kind of err on a lot of times. You may find yourself, you don't get to look down on the faith of others. This is the tough one, isn't it? We come to a place where we think we figured it out and we know it now and we need others to know it like us, but we don't get to look down on the faith of others. We won't get to say that's not real faith. When someone's struggling with faith, what's the call that we read here? Being there struggling with them. That's right. When someone's having a hard time and they're walking away, we don't wave goodbye, we walk with them. We become the one who walks alongside no matter what comes their way in life and how they struggle with this idea of a faith. Because we believe that God is at work in all and through all and has great plans for us all. You see, their faith becomes your problem too. Their faith problem becomes your problem too. Close us up this morning as we've had a chance to celebrate. It was awesome. Thank y'all for letting me be a part of the day. All of you this morning. I love my boys, by the way. They've been awesome. Thank y'all for letting me hang out with you in the sanctuary doing Bible study now for the past few months. Been lots of fun with my old boys. Yeah. Thank y'all for letting me be a part of the day. Families, thank y'all for being a part of the day. One of the things that's so true is we look at the baptism and we look at what we've done today, remembering what God has already done. Being united gives us a chance to grow up in this together. You're not alone. Even though you're taking a huge step in your faith today, you're not alone in this. We're going to walk with you. All of you out there say, you know what? I haven't done what they've done. I've never been baptized. I've wondered about it. I've thought about it. If that's something that you're interested in, let us know. Because we want to make a promise to you to walk with you in your faith as well. You see, who we choose or get stuck with will greatly impact who we grow up to be. And today we've got to see some of our youth here at the church say, you know what, we want to join together with the believers around the world to walk through life together because it will shape and it will form you who you choose to walk with. Growing up in our faith only happens together. And so to close us up this morning, I'm going to run you through our questions that we've asked and put the last one before you. On week two, as we looked at this idea of a childlike faith, we said, where are you on the journey? We're all on a journey in some way. We're all at a different place maybe this morning. But where are you on the journey? What childish things do you need to put behind you? What's keeping you from that opportunity to mature in this life? Everyone has a responsibility. So what's your part? Everyone has a responsibility. So what's your part? And today, closing it up, growing up in our faith only happens together. So who are you standing with? Growing up in our faith only happens together. So who are you standing with? Let's pray. As we look at words that have been spoken and read for so long, as we look at the opportunity we've had this morning to reaffirm our faith, to remember, God, what it was like on that day when some of us were baptized, and God, the promise that you do us and the work you do in us. God, this call that we have to be united, to be together. Strive for that bond of peace that gives us the opportunity to mature and to grow into the people that you have created us to be. Because God, we know when we do that, that's when we have opportunity to really and truly live life to the fullest, knowing good and well that it's a life that cannot be taken away. God, holding tight to the promise that death has been defeated and that through you, God, we have life. So today, this celebration begins. For some who've taken that step in faith, for others of us, God, it continues on. And for some of us, we're still reaching and searching. God, wherever we are on the journey this morning, may it become clearer to us that you are the God who chose to love. And now we're called to love one another. And as that happens, God, we truly do grow and mature. It's in your name we pray. Amen. I invite you to your feet as we close this morning in worship and have the offering plates coming around.
see what you can do, oh God of wonders. Your power has no end. Things you've done before in greater measure, you will do again. 'Cause there's no prison wall you can bring through, no mountain you can move, all things impossible. There's no broken body you can raise, no soul that you can save, all things impossible. The darkest night, you can light it up.
Call me waking you city. Oh God, oh.
Go forth in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.